Hello students, welcome to today's English class. Today we'll be exploring further the chapter Ishwaran the Storyteller. As I told you, this is the chapter about a marvelous storyteller Ishwaran, and this entire story of Ishwaran is being told here by his employer Mahendra to one of his friends Ganesh. And yesterday we just came to know the talent of Ishwaran in telling stories, how he would make even ordinary looking stories look extraordinary using his voice modulation, using his histrionics, using his innovation, using his extreme creativity. Fine. And he started Mahendra telling a story about an elephant, and that story was quite interesting, in which he himself turned out to be a hero, and he hit the elephant on the third toenail using some technique of karate, and the elephant collapsed onto the ground, and later it was taken by the Mahavat, and veterinary surgeon came and his services were availed. Then it was shown that on particular day, when both of them, Ishwaran and Mahendra, they were staying in a factory, it was an auspicious day. Ishwaran, who was an excellent cook as well, who was expert at culinary skills, he cooked a delicious meal. The meal was served to Mahendra, and after serving the meal, Ishwaran started telling a very supernatural story. He started giving a garish account. Garish, I told you, garish means something that is too much colorful, that is too much gaudy in appearance, that seems to be quite bad in taste, that is unpleasant in taste. So unpleasant kind of story, you know, considering an element of violence, considering an element of horror. So such things are not liked when you have just appreciated a delicious meal. So when he started giving a vivid description of his horrible story by saying that the factory they were staying was a haunted place, it was visited by ghosts, and Ishwaran himself had seen human skull lying here and there on a couple of occasions. Fine. So this took Mahendran out of the reverie he was into. After enjoying the delicious meal, after enjoying the sumptuous meal, Mahendra was lost in the pleasures of that meal. He was in a kind of reverie, he was in a kind of daydream. But the horrible description of Ishwaran's story about the place being haunted brought him out of that reverie, and let's see how he continued this story. He went on to narrate how he sometimes saw ghosts at night in the factory. "I am not easily frightened by these things, sir," he said. "I am brave fellow, sir, but one horrible ghost of a woman which appears off and on at midnight during the full moon in this factory. It is an ugly creature, sir, with matted hair." Matted means tangled, uncombed, tangled hair, and shriveled face. Face with wrinkles and shrunken face, like a skeleton holding a fetus in its arms. The woman ghost appears as if she is like a skeleton. Skeleton, you know, the structure of bones, holding a fetus. Fetus means unborn, unborn baby in its arms. So it looks so horrible, it looks so ghastly, it looks so scaring. Mahendra shivered at the description. This description was so horrible, description was so scary, that it turned Mahendra into shivers. He started shivering, he started shaking with fear, and interrupted the description sharply, quickly. "You are crazy, Ishwaran. You are mad, Ishwaran. You are insane, Ishwaran. You are lunatic, Ishwaran. Pagal ho gaye ho kya? There are no such things as ghosts or spirits. They are false. They don't exist. It is all a figment of your imagination. It's just your imagination running riot. It's your imagination running wild. It's the product of your imagination. There are no ghosts in this world." get your digestive system examined. It seems there is something wrong with your digestive system that makes you come out with these false, supernatural, horrible, scary stories. Don't tell me that there are ghosts. There are no ghosts. And go and get your head examined as well. Your head, your brain is not working, functioning properly. You are talking nonsense. You are talking senseless. You are talking irrational. He left the room and retired for night. So Ishwaran left the room and retired for night means he went to bed and fell asleep. Mahendra left the room and retired for night, expecting Ishwaran to sulk for a couple of days. He expected that Ishwaran would sulk. Sulk means, here the meaning of sulk is, sulk. The meaning of sulk here is, this particular word sulk I would like to explain to you. Sulk means to stay irritated. To stay irritated, here in this sense. Mahendra thought, since he had scolded Ishwaran the previous night, so for a couple of days, he would stay irritated, he would stay annoyed, he would stay angry. Angry to servant, or servant, as servant, he won't be annoyed or irritated, we can say. But the next morning, he was surprised. Mahendra was surprised to find the cook as cheerful, as talkative ever. So it means Ishwaran hadn't taken the scolding to his heart. And next day, he was as cheerful, as talkative as ever. From that day on, Mahendra, for all his brave talk, went to bed with a certain unease. For that day on, after that day, for all his brave talk, whatever Ishwaran was indulged into speaking bravery, with bravery, whatever horrible accounts of ghosts or whatever supernatural stories he had told, Mahendra went to bed with a certain unease. There was discomfort. There was some sense of fear in Mahendra's heart. He couldn't sleep. The story, the description of the ghost remained alive in his mind, which didn't let him sleep with easiness. Every night he peered into the darkness. Every night he looked intently into the darkness outside through the window next to his bed, trying to make sure that there was no movement of dark shapes in the vicinity. Vicinity means in the area around. Actually, those descriptions had lingered on in his mind. Those ghastly descriptions of Ishwaran's ghost story had stayed on his mind, and they didn't let him sleep. Every now and then he would look up from bed, peep out of the window and looked for certain dark shapes in the vicinity, in the area around, but he could only see a sea of darkness with the twinkling lights of the factory miles away. He couldn't find anybody, any horrible shape. He had always liked to admire the milk white landscape on full moon nights. You know, on the full moon nights, the entire landscape is bathed in the moonlight. It looks like milk white landscape. It looks like milk white area. And he had always liked the scene outside in a full moon night. But after hearing Ishwaran's story of the female ghost, he avoided looking out of his window on the day of full moon night, altogether when the moon was full. So even he didn't have the courage to look out when the day was full. When the moon was full, I'm extremely sorry. When the moon was full, fine. It developed a fear in his heart. The fear stayed deep in his heart that the full moon night, which he used to enjoy, which he used to relish, which he used to praise a lot previously, even he started avoiding such full moon nights. Such a deep impression Ishwaran's ghost story had caused to Mahendra. One day, Mahendra was woken up from his sleep by a low moan close to his window. One day, he heard a low moan. Moan means a sound of crying in pain. When somebody cries in grief or somebody cries in pain, that sound is moan. So he heard a moaning sound close to his window. At first he put it down to a cat. Putting it down to means he just associated it with a cat. He thought it was the sound of a cat prowling. Prowling means wandering here and there, looking for mice, looking for a mouse. Fine, looking for some mice, but the sound was too guttural for a cat. The sound was too guttural. The sound was too deep. It didn't appear to be the sound of a cat. Fine. So such great fear the story of Ishwaran had caused on the mind of Mahendra, that he just started fearing, and he thought that there was a ghost around. In fact, this proves that he had started believing that there was a ghost. Otherwise, had he been a brave person who didn't believe in the existence of the ghosts, as he had told Ishwaran, so he wouldn't have been scared. But even a sound of groan, afraid him. And he first, though he tried to associate it with the sound of a cat, but then when he closely and intentively heard the sound, he found that the sound was too guttural, the sound was too harsh, it was too throaty. It didn't appear to be of a cat. He resisted the curiosity, though there was a curiosity in his mind. There was an inquisitiveness in his mind. He wanted to go and look what the sound was, but he resisted that curiosity. He controlled that curiosity to look out, lest he should behold a sight. Lest means otherwise he would behold a sight, he would look at a sight which would stop his heart. The sight could be so terrible, and he was so soft-hearted that his heart would stop beating. He could have a heart attack, he could have a heart failure seeing that expected horrible sight outside. So he resisted the temptation, he resisted the curiosity, and he didn't dare to look out what the sound was and who the sound belonged to. But the wailing again means the loud sound of crying. Mourning after some time becomes wailing, became louder and less feline. Feline means less belonging to cats. Something belonging to cats is feline. He couldn't resist the temptation anymore. He couldn't resist the curiosity. Lowering himself to the level of windowsill, he bent himself to the level of windowsill. Windowsill, that is the shelf, a narrow shelf alongside of window. He leaned forward to have a look outside of the window. He lowered himself in the white sheet of moonlight outside. He could see, because it was full moon night. There, not too far away, was a dark cloudy form. He could see something cloudy that was clutching a bundle. So this was a horrible spectacle. This was a eerie spectacle. Mahendra broke into a cold sweat. Mahendra jammed there. He started sweating. He turned cold and fell back on the pillow. He feared. He rushed back to the bed and fell back on the pillow, panting, breathing hard, as if he had seen a ghost. As he gradually recovered from this was the ghastly experience which put him into a shock, and he went almost unconscious. He got fainted, he lost control over his senses, and as he gradually recovered from the ghastly experience, horrible experience, he began to reason with himself. He started giving him logics. And finally, he concluded that it must have been some sort of auto-suggestion. Since he didn't believe, He was a logical man. He thought, how could there be a ghost? So he thought it might have been some auto-suggestion. Auto-suggestion means something that your mind suggests to you that it exists, but it doesn't exist actually. It's the product of your mind. It's the figment of imagination. He thought his mind played some trick that his subconscious had played on him. We say that there is one consciousness and one subconsciousness, that is our inner mind. So he thought his subconscious had played some trick on him. It was an illusion that he watched. So he termed his horrible experience as an illusion. Or there is another word, hallucination. Hallucination. A sight that you witness out of your subconscious playing a trick with you, but that doesn't actually exist, is illusion or hallucination. So he termed it to be either a illusion or hallucination, a trick played by his subconscious, an auto-suggestion that his mind suggested to, because he had been thinking about ghosts for last many nights, so he happened to see a ghost when there was not any ghost. So this way he convinced himself, he gave himself reasons, he gave himself logics. By the time he had got up in the morning and had a bath and come out to have his breakfast, the horror of the previous night had faded from his memory, thankfully. Time had healed him, time had shown its impact, and there was no horror left in his mind. Ishwaran greeted him at the door with his lunch packet and his bag as usual. Just as Mahendra was tapping out, Ishwar grinned, Ishwar smiled, exposing his old teeth, broad smile, ha ha ha, and said, "Sir, remember the other day? Remember the day when I was telling you about the female ghost with a fetus in its arms? You were so angry with me that day for imagining things that I imagine things. It could be the figment of my imagination. Well, you saw her yourself last night. I came running hearing the sound of mourning. I also got up and I also heard the sound of crying that was coming from your room. So... you also experienced the same. Now you say it is the figment of imagination. That day too you were scolding me." A chill went down Mahendra's spine. The very reminder of the scary incident made Mahendra scared again. Fine. He just got frightened again. When a chill goes down your spine, it means you are extremely nervous and you are extremely frightened. He didn't wait for Ishwaran to complete his sentence. He understood what Ishwaran was mentioning about. He hurried away to his office and handed in his papers. That particular incident of the horrible night left a deep impact in Mahendra's mind, and he took an important decision of his life. The next day, he hurried back to office and handed the papers to boss, means to submit his resignation. He submitted his resignation from the job, he took a decision to leave the haunted place, that factory that was visited by ghosts, the very next day. This is the beautiful story composed by R.K. Lakshman. So this was the story of Ishwaran, an expert storyteller who brought his stories so close to reality that they appeared to be real, and they start such an impact on the minds of the people that people started believing in the stories to be true and they started behaving according to the story. So students, this is the end of the chapter today. You are advised to make notebooks and write glossary, all difficult expressions and words in your notebooks along with their meanings, and solve its NCERT exercise in your notebooks. Thank you very much. Take good care of yourself.